Ladies and gentlemen, good day. Myself Sunil Mishra, and I'm looking after investor relations for the company. This being our first interaction of this calendar, hence taking this opportunity to wish you a very happy and prosperous new year. So welcome to today's conference call with the T&D India Ltd management team. We have organized this conference call to present financial results for the third quarter and 9 months ended 31st December 2017. Now let me first introduce my management team available on this call. We have with us Mr. Sunil Wadhwa, Managing Director, T&D India Ltd. Today, unfortunately, Mr. Gaurav Negi, our whole-time director and CFO, is not well. In his place, Mr. Sushil Kumar, who is our financial planning and analysis leader, is available with us to present and answer your questions in the absence of Mr. Negi. Also sitting with us, Mr. Manoj Prasad Singh, Company Secretary, Mr. Sandeep Janjaria, our commercial leader, and Mr. Anshul Madan, our communications leader. Please note that this conference call is scheduled up to 5 p.m. I hope you would have received the investor analyst presentation and would have read the disclaimer on slide number 2. So we will now begin with Mr. Sandeep Janjaria, our commercial leader, presenting the key highlights, followed by Mr. Wadhwa and Mr. Sushil Kumar. I now invite Mr. Sandeep Janjaria to begin. Over to Sandeep.
Thanks, Sunil, and good afternoon, everybody. So I welcome you all on the call. And so the major highlights for the quarter in terms of order intake was that we have been able to secure orders worth about 783 crores in this quarter, the highlights being the order from Sterlite Power Grid Ventures for a TBCB package for building two new substations and some extension base in the northeast. Then we have received a 400 kV GIS substation order from JETCO, which is one of our esteemed clients in the state electricity board sector. We have received the upgradation and annual maintenance contract for 5 years for the National Load Dispatch Center for Bangladesh. So with this now we have the Bangladesh, India, Sri Lanka and Nepal, all the load dispatch centers with us, Bhutan as well. In addition to that, we have got an order for 66 kV GIS to be built in Thimphu from Bhutan Power. And so there are some other notable project orders. From NTPC BHL, we have secured an order for 765 kV circuit breakers and some automation orders from Delhi Transco. Along with this, in terms of total complete the year for financial year 18, which has gone, we have commissioned about 48 substations, and which includes 15 substations which have been commissioned in the third quarter. And the notable commissionings which have happened in the third quarter are 400 kV air-insulated substation at Chhattisgarh for Chhattisgarh State Board, 400 by 220 kV substations at MSETCL at Kudus. Then there have been some substation extension packages for Power Grid, which have been commissioned in Jind and Kathal, and 400 kV AIS substations in Kanpur. And the TBCB package of Mega, which we had taken, so the 400 kV AIS commissioned for them in Greater Noida. And along with that, we commissioned some base of RRVPNL 400 kV in Bikaner. One of the prestigious projects which we had taken from Sterlite, which was in the Amargarh near Srinagar, Jammu and Kashmir, is ready for commissioning ahead of time. So these have been certain noticeable execution excellence which has been delivered by the company during this quarter and for the year. So now I will invite Sunil to, I think, take over.
So
So Sandeep got us a lot of orders and our team executed it. So the challenge really was to see that under the tough conditions that we are all going through in the infrastructure space, not only in India, globally, how do we improve our bottom line? So the only thing which we thought was yet to really be focused on a very strong basis was cash. So over the year, and especially in the last quarter, the company really had a gathered momentum, and our focus on cash was very, very strong. And I'm happy to inform you that we became debt-free sometime in December, early December. And over the year, we have generated about 7.3 billion rupees in the nine-month period free cash flow. So as a result, the opening borrowings, which was close to 290 crores rupees, we converted them into it was 450 crores of borrowing in the beginning of the year, and we closed December at 290 crores of net cash surplus, so which is net of borrowings. So this has been a great achievement by the team, and on all fronts, whether it is working capital management, and especially the old receivables have been reduced drastically from the opening balance by about, I think, close to 30%. The collection against the retentions, which were monies stuck with the customers for closeouts, probably we collected almost three times what we collected in any year in the last 5 years from the retention accounts. So as a result, the position from a borrowing of 450 crores got converted into close to 300 crores of surplus cash. On the order intake, Sandeep, we have basically, I'll just pass over briefly to Sandeep again on the order intake analysis for the third quarter and 9 months, and then we'll go on to the financial numbers and Sunil will take over.
Thanks, Sunil. I think so for the third quarter number, it's at 783 crores of order intake, but when we look at the 9 months, then we are neck to neck with the what we did in 2016. And this being a capex driven cycle, the mostly the projects which come for us. So that's why it's basically the orders are normally decided by the customer depending upon the project cycles which are there. So like for example, last year we had a very good third quarter but this year we had a very good second quarter. So looking into that, the overall numbers are matching, and we are very well positioned with the order in hand of 72 billion, which is equivalent to about 1.5 years of sale. So now I would request Sushil to take over.
Yeah, good afternoon. As we take the financial highlights, if you move to page 6, in terms of sales execution, it was a good performance represented by 18 to 19% growth on 3 month period, as well as YTD 9 month basis. Sales for the quarter stood at 1,438 crore versus 1,214 crore in the last year for the 3 month period. And on a 9 month basis, sales stood at 3,571 crore versus 3,000 crore last year. So it was a very strong project execution driving the revenue growth for us. Page 7, next page, which is profit after tax. We recorded profit after tax of approximately 72 crore. Which represents a strong 62% growth versus last year's same quarter. Profit growth is driven by volumes and strong execution, as well as the cost initiatives that the company is taking. On a 9 month basis, profit after tax stood at 181 crore versus a loss of 132 crore last year. So last year, if you recall, there were losses largely on account of one-time provisioning, but even excluding one-time impact, profit improved significantly. If we move to next page, which is page 8, related to fund position, as Sunil already explained about the fund position, happy to again communicate the end of the quarter. The company is debt-free and has a net cash surplus of 290 crores. This is a significant improvement versus last year when the company was a net borrower to the extent of 625 crores. Strong focus on project execution and retention collections, as mentioned by Sunil and under his leadership, is driving the cash performance for the company. If you go to the last page, which is the final summary, overall sales of 1,438 crores, a growth of 18%. The operating profit, which is EBIT, was at 134 crore, a growth of 31%. Profit after tax of 72 crore, representing a growth of 62%, and a strong cash performance of 390 crore cash generation in the quarter. With this, I think we now turn it to the questions, please.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Thank you. The first question is from the line of Sudhir Jain from HDFC Securities. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. If one looks at the order inflows for the quarter and even for the previous quarter, that is Q2, in the range of 700 to 800 crores, if I look and compare it with the other MNCs in the same space which are listed, the order inflows have been muted. And plus, if I look at the total order book also, in terms of the trailing 12-month revenues, the book-to-bill has come down from about 2.1 to 1.7. So are we losing out to competition in some of the orders?
So just to tell you is that when we compare ourselves to other MNCs, I think probably it's not like-to-like because we are primarily transmission and many other MNCs are having a diversified portfolio as compared to us. That is one thing. And when we are tracking the market share, which is there for us for last about 3 to 4 years, our market share remains at close to about 17 to 18%. So we are not losing market as compared to our competitors.
In fact, there is a marginal increase of close to 1% in the market share.
Okay, how much of the, if broadly, can we, for the 9 months or for the full year, divide the revenue between power T&D and other sectors like automation and others?
So it will be very difficult to give a split on the call right
now. Not exact numbers, but some ballpark rough figure that if you can indicate.
So generally, I think I can share about the split between products and projects, which is close to 50% each, but then going into automation and other sub-segments will be very difficult at this stage. But that is in the trend that's continuing. And in addition to what you asked in the last time to Sandeep, one of the reasons of reduction in backlog is partially because of execution of HVDC jumper project. Otherwise, in terms of regular order booking, as Sandeep mentioned, the order are coming and execution is happening fast.
So therefore, one suggestion from analyst side is that if we can, like other MNCs, break the revenue division-wise, like they do it, if you look at, for example, ABB's revenue, they clearly divide it in four segments. That will be helpful in terms of understanding what kind of trajectory we are in. So one more question is on, services, solar and exports. What kind of percentage they are in total revenues? You can talk about FY17 or 9 months, and as well in the order book.
So solar, I think we won't be able to share the details right now. Service is close to 3 to 4% of revenue, and exports continue to be at the level of 10 to 11% range.
And in terms of order inflows and order book?
Yeah, the same trend continues in terms of order book and execution.
Okay, and one last question is that, other companies in the space are talking about OPEX-led opportunities when CAPEX-led opportunities are not panning out in domestic market, and more so into digitalization. Both Siemens and ABB have spoken about it, and they are banking on their global platforms. Like, for example, ABB has got ABB Ability. You guys have Predix with GE. So is there a thought process of utilizing that and applying that to your current asset base in India and converting it into a new stream of revenues?
Yeah, so I think we are also looking into many of the projects which are OPEX-based projects, but the time for these projects to mature is comparatively higher. So this is something which we are also working on, but we have to still see the results of it in the coming time.
Sure, that's it. Good luck to you guys. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Renu Ved from IIFL. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Good evening, sir. Few questions. First, wanting to understand a little more on the 3Q results and the exceptional items that we have shared. If we recollect back last year when there was this tax, C-form related one-off that we had done, it was split between then other expenses and interest. So if you can explain us what was the split in terms of reversal in this quarter, as in which heads were they accounted for?
So the reversal is mostly in the other income of 105 crore, which is highlighted in the financial statements. There's not much impact of interest in the C-form reversal.
Okay, because as in the footnotes, there is a note mentioned for reference. So we were just trying to wonder if there is any correlation there as well on the finance charges. Sure. So as in the entire amount is related in the other income itself, and the other expense only includes bad debt provisions of 22 crores.
Yes.
So when we, only for the purpose of comparison analysis, if we add back as in this 22 crores to your operating profits, then margin still just around 9.5%. And despite the strong volume execution that we've seen in this quarter, operating margins of 9.5% look optically weak. So is there something that we should read on the gross margins in this quarter? Were there any timing issues or any EPC projects where margins lagged? Or probably you think what would be the reason low margins orders getting executed?
So I'll say, Ms. Bait, that margins have been stable. And as explained in the earlier calls, that there's a competitive pressure in the market, and we see that, there is a competition. So as already communicated by Gaurav in the earlier call, the management initiative is to have a strong execution performance and try to sustain and improve the margins. And I think comparison of quarter on quarter gross profit or EBITDA is not the right comparison. But if you take a period of 9 months and the GP ratio comes close to 30%, which is
correct,
something that the management is focusing on. And quarter on quarter is definitely impacted by the mix of projects and the timing of for realization of opportunities. But I think my suggestion that let's look for 9 months on a sustainable or long term.
Yeah, then the YTD 30-30.5% gross margins in your view is fairly sustainable.
That's what we target for.
Sure, you are. And so overall, what would be your comments in terms of the pace of execution now that the GST headwinds are behind and we have a fairly strong backlog? Also citing some inputs on how has been the status of execution on the CK2. So what proportion of the billing is still pending for us in the backlog? And what proportion was billed in this financial year YTD?
So as explained in the last investor call, there was some impact of GST in the last quarter, and that's why the revenues were lower. And we have been able to pull those revenues into the quarter. And execution has been fairly strong, and Sandeep has already explained the list of key projects that were executed, and even the projects like Sterlite, which have been executed at a faster pace. But I think 1,500, close to 1,438 crore is a fairly good execution pace. The execution of projects is dependent on us as well as the availability of site and the customer position in terms of funding and their project management. As far as we are concerned, I'll say that the company is very well equipped to even execute faster and more projects.
Mm-hmm.
And to the second question of CKL2, we are close to 70% of execution, and balance 30% will be executed in this financial year and the next financial year.
Raj, and my last question for you is, overall, the comments that we have been having on the end markets have been a bit more cautious, especially on the domestic transmission side. Last two quarters, if we see, order inflow, though, has been a bit lower. YTD, the order book is healthy. So in this perspective, as in what is our strategy, the way we are looking at the end markets, are we being more selective with respect to the orders in the market, or is that the market volume itself has declined? So what is our perspective on the order pipeline and the order info trajectory that we are targeting? Thank you, and that's it from my side.
Okay, Sunil Wadhwa here.
Yeah.
I think the overall market that we are addressing has remained steady.
Mm-hmm.
There are intra market, there are some shifts. For example, Power Grid per se is lower this year. In the current calendar, we see lower than last year. But the state electricity boards are coming up almost more than two times what they had in 2017.
Okay.
So it's a shift. And secondly, because also the tariff-based bidding, so Power Grid as such may not actually keep getting, having so much orders to give, because they have to compete with other private players. So overall, we have seen the pipeline for the current year, when I say means 2018, is slightly higher on the margin, but I would say that it is on the same number as we saw last year. New players that we're seeing in the market going forward, of course, solar continues to be a strong space. It's growing. We see a lot of projects coming up on hybrids and storage, and there is more shift onto the GIS side. That's one other thing. We also see more HVDC projects coming up, one or two in India, maybe towards the end of the year, or maybe early next year. And in the neighboring countries, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka, we see three projects coming on HVDC side. Now, internally, what we are planning is to relook at our mix of offerings. We do have a range of products and services, including the EPC services, and again, a very wide range of margins. So all we are looking at is how do we, even if we have the same market share, how do we look at a higher share of the high-margin products that we sell compared to what they are today. And lastly, I think the green corridors is something on the external side we see a huge push. I mean, take the case of Kargil and Leh area. There's a strong discussion. There's a lot of discussion happening on, solar capacity to be put up there, which now in the current pricing makes sense, with a little bit more on transmission cost, but overall it still makes sense. And I think whoever we talk to in the government circles, there is going to be much more requirement of transmission arising out of renewables.
Thank you, sir, and all the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Charanjit Singh from B&K Securities. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. Sir, in your order inflow, we have consistently seen, some of the GIS orders being, picked up from the state transcos. So in our current, order backlog, how large will be the GIS proportion? What will be our market share in this, GIS segment? And how do we see GIS market growing forward?
So I think for the GIS, what we are seeing the shift in the market is that more than 50% of the opportunities which were earlier AIS is slowly getting converted to GIS. So today more than 50% of the conventional market from states and this thing has moved to GIS, and we are seeing about 15% of our portfolio is coming from the GIS, which is the pure GIS. But if you look in terms of project and all, then the ratio is much higher, because then there are a lot of paraphernalia also, which is the conventional part which we supply along with the GIS.
And so how do you see this market growing, from state transcos? Which state transcos you see will be placing out more orders?
So the mostly when we are tracking the state transmission companies, so this year a healthy pipeline we are looking, which is coming from West Bengal, Tamil Nadu, Telangana, UP, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, and there are certain others which have also some decent amount of pipeline, like OPTCL and Jharkhand and all. So there are projects which we are seeing coming from various state utilities, and I think after the complete state transmission network is built, the more focus will be there on the intra-state, which is the prerogative of the state electricity boards.
And so the other question is like, you know, we have got some initial success in Bangladesh and we are eyeing some projects in Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, both on HVDC side. So it means that our proportion of exports should go up incrementally from here on. So how do we see that market, you know, looking at these four geographies, Bhutan, Nepal, Sri Lanka and Bangladesh, how large is the opportunity for us? And how, when do we see, you know, this entire thing panning out?
So I think Bangladesh, there are many opportunities on which presently we are working, and presently also some smaller ongoing projects we already have in Sri Lanka, Bhutan, Bangladesh, including some successes like what I read is 6 GIS substation in Bhutan, upgrade of National Load Dispatch Center in Bangladesh. But like HVDC and all, we are expecting the system studies to be completed and tenders to be out by the end of the year. So looking into the complex nature of HVDC, we are expecting the ordering to happen somewhere by in another year's time from now. So that's going to impact the order intake and revenues for the 2019 onwards and not in 18.
Mm-hmm. And sir, how large these projects could be? Like they are similar to what we had in India, 5,000 crores worth, or they could be bigger?
No, they would be much smaller in nature because the projects which were in India, which we had like 5,000 crores, so that was like transmitting 6,000 megawatts from one location to the other. But these projects which are coming will be typically in the range of about 1,000 megawatts. So we expect them to be close to be around 1,000 crores or around that
one. Okay, sir. And so the last question from my side is, we have seen this, you know, good bus bar protection scheme, you know, order from Delhi Transco, which you have mentioned it's an automation order. And if you can, you know, tell us like what is the size of this order and, you know, what all will be, you know, the implications if, you know, see that the other DISCOMs also adopting these kind of, you know, automation, you know, systems. And there could be acceleration, you know, going forward as Uday program is getting implemented. So DISCOMs will start doing CapEx and the automation, you know, segment could pick up for us. So you can give us more clarity on this aspect.
Yeah, I'll just, so it's basically when we say bus bar protection, so it's not on the DISCOM side, but it is again on the transmission side because it is DTL and not the Tatas and the Reliance, which is there. And this is basically implementing bus bar protection schemes in certain older projects which were where automation was not so high level. But these type of schemes we keep on getting inquiries from various other state electricity boards, which we keep on working and winning. So difficult to comment on an individual order, but this is our kind of continuous focus area. Which we are working with various state electricity board, and this is which we are doing it not for today or yesterday, but maybe for last few years.
Yeah, but sir, on the DISCOM side, there has been a lot of talk about automation. Do you see that we will have some play over there, and this distribution automation systems and the other, you know, systems which DISCOMs could implement, or even the Transco's automation side?
So yeah, we are actually, so we are expecting the next big investment coming in DISCOM center, DISCOM side on the automation. So we expect, like for example, distribution management system and upgrade of relays to 61850 and then implementing of new relay technologies in DISCOM, including SCADA. So this is we are expecting, and we are working with various DISCOMs to advise them. So, but the result
is executed with Tata Power Bombay.
Yeah, again, yeah. The Tata project distribution management, we have just executed and completed the job. So this is something which is part of our focus and we are continuously working towards it.
Okay, sir. So thanks a lot. That's all from my side. All the best for the future.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Shivadeep Mitra from JM Financial. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello. Yeah, hi. I'm sorry I joined the call a little late, so at the risk of repetition, I'm just going to ask these questions. See, essentially what we are looking at is, you know, in the first half of the year, we've seen very high EBIT margins, and now in this quarter we've seen, you know, on an adjusted basis, the EBIT margin probably coming off to closer to 10% versus maybe closer to 10% earlier. So just wanted to understand that this would be in line with your long-term guidance of a 7 to 8% EBIT margin, which is what you have been guiding as a sustainable number. And secondly, also wanted to understand that is this also related to the execution pattern of the Edge UTC project?
So, Mr. Sabyasachi, we don't give a forward-looking statement. However, in terms of response to your questions, we have been giving we are not giving any forward-looking statements, but as a part of the question and answers of the earlier calls, we have given some information that we want to sustain the current level of margin, and it was also explained by Gaurav in the last call that, you know, we have multiple projects, and quarter-on-quarter numbers are definitely impacted by mix of projects and the realization of opportunities in few projects. So if you look at the YTD 9-month numbers, the gross profit ratio of close to 30% and EBIT margin of 8 to 9%, that's the range that management definitely works for, and we try to take all the opportunities and initiatives to improve whatever we can.
Okay. Understood. And on the Edge UTC project, is it possible to share how much of the Edge UTC is still in the order book?
So close to 500 crore of Edge UTC is in the backlog.
And this is expected to get completed by when?
So part of it will get completed in this financial year and balance in the next financial year.
Understood. Last question from my side is, we understand that naturally we are looking at power grid related ordering being more subdued even going ahead. At least that's what they were also indicating on their call. And again, not really seeing that kind of pickup in terms of the DISCOM related ordering. So how do you see the market moving ahead, and where are the new opportunities?
So I think so what we are seeing today in the market is that so 2-3 places we are seeing new opportunities coming up. So one is the state electricity board. So whatever market is not coming from power grid, but there is a big thrust from state electricity boards to improve their infrastructure and transmission. So there is an increased market which we are looking from state electricity boards. Second, we are looking at solar. So because last year solar was quite a bit lull, but this year we have seen that about 8 to 9 gigawatt tenders have already come in the first quarter or maybe in last 2 months. So that is one area which we are closely working with our customers. And then also we are looking at storage solutions, which is there, which is part of our global portfolio, that how we are able to support the developers in actually building more sustainable solar and wind solutions with battery storage systems. Apart from that, as Sunil has said in his last comment, was that we are looking at, and there is a big generation of renewables which is being planned in Leh and Ladakh, and the evacuation of that is expected to happen through HVDC technology. So those projects also, we are expecting it to come sometime by the end of the year.
Any indication as to how each of these baskets would be in terms of market size, especially the SEB component of it?
So I think the SEB component will be close to about 1 billion.
This is 1 billion over the next 2 to 3 years, or in the next 1 or 2 years itself?
It's 1 to 2 years, basically.
Okay.
Yeah, $1 billion.
Yeah, understood. And the rest of the baskets, whether it's solar or others, is there any indication of how large those can be?
So that we are actually working, because there are different buying patterns in the market for solar. So some go for total EPC and some go for breakup and things like that. So that is still we are working, and will be difficult to project at this point of time.
Understood. So even the Leh Ladakh project is still not very clear, because I understand it would be a government project.
So Leh Ladakh, maybe yes, it may be the evacuation. So we are working. Yeah, most likely it will be with power grid, but in Leh Ladakh we are talking about the transmission evacuation part. which will be like through an HVDC. So that will be a substantial project, but the size, we are still working on it.
Mm-hmm. So this is again expected next fiscal, or maybe could get slightly delayed?
We expect it to happen maybe in next fiscal only.
Understood. Thank you so much. That's it from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sabyasachi Mukherjee from India Nivesh Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi. Good evening, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. I wanted to understand that if you look at the EBITDA margin, so that the EBIT margin minus the other income. So if you look at the EBITDA margin, it's around 3.5% in this quarter, whereas in the last two quarters it was around 9%. So the raw material cost has gone up from 69% as a percentage of sales from 69% to 74% this quarter. So what exactly, I wanted to understand the product mix, what was the reason behind this rise in raw material cost?
So, Mr. Sabyasachi, if you move to the page 9 of the presentation that we have shared, the EBITDA margin or EBIT margin, this includes, as we already given the notes to the financial statement publication and in this presentation, that the one-off item, I'll not say exception because they are the one-off item for the quarter, but though operational, are close to 197 million. And excluding that, most of the other income is related to the recognition of revenue on account of faster collection of retention, as explained by Sunil on the cash performance. And this is quite operational, but this is more a change in the way it is represented because of the classification and change due to Ind AS. Overall, on the P&L, because of this, there is no P&L impact. This is a wash. The negative impact of this retention fair valuation is already netted off from the revenue of 1,438 crore, even in the financial statements. So all of this other income, I'll say, is operational except the one given in the note. And if you make these adjustments, the EBITDA margin, or let's say EBIT margin, will be close to 8% range that we have shown in the presentation.
The note you are mentioning, it is the slump sale you are referring to, right? That is of 65 million.
Yeah, so one is slump sale of 65 million, and then if you look at the note 2 and 3 of the financial statement, we said that there is a release of provision to the extent of 360 million for indirect tax, and provision of financial reserves for customer financial position to the extent of 224 million. If you include all three elements together, the impact on the financial statement is a net income or profit of 197 million. I'll say that excluding 65 million of GFSS sale, which was exceptional, or you can say one time, others are though operational, but they are key large items in the financials. And again, as I mentioned to Ms. Baid earlier, that looking at the quarter number gives a different impression because it depends on the execution of the project and mix of project. If you look at the YTD 9-month basis, we are close to the range of 8.5% of EBIT margin, and that's what management has been already communicating on most of the occasions.
Okay. And sir, so this other income that is caused by the reversal of around 105 crores this quarter, do you expect in the coming quarters to happen, the figure likely to remain same? Or?
So I'll
clarify, 105 is not all reversals.
Yeah, so I'll just give you some split for the benefit of all. Out of 105 crores, 6.5 crore is related to the, or rather 6 crore is related to the slump sale.
Right.
Balance 99 crore has two parts. One is the 36 crore related to reversal of C-form provisions. Then around 55 to 60 crore is related to the retention, is recognition of income because of the retention collection. This pattern is expected to continue and will depend on the cash flow generation and the recognition of revenue during the quarter as per the accounting concept. But overall for the quarter, and I think for the earlier quarters as well, now India thing is stabilized and it's a wash, it's a neutral impact. The corresponding negative impact is already netted off from the revenue.
Okay.
And regarding the CFOM reversal or indirect tax reversal, we made a provision, and from management side, we continue to push for recovery of all the opportunities, and we made a significant progress towards the collection of forms. It will be our effort to recover whatever provisions we have made by way of operational efficiencies. But the impact cannot be given at present, and it will depend on the realization of those opportunities.
Sir, just to understand one thing, this is the tax is the reversal of tax is with reference to something it has to do with the tax litigation that you have mentioned in the FY17 annual report as well. So we have incurred around 680 million of interest expense on taxes, and also the provision that has been made towards the tax litigation in FY17. Is that related to this thing only?
So as a part of the accounting principle and conservatism, we have been making provision of the litigation as well as the provision for non-collection and deposit of e-form with the authorities. Now, this reversal is mostly related to the collection of e-form and reversal of provisions made against the e-form. This one is not related to litigation at present.
Okay. And one more thing is, you have told that by this quarter you have become debt free. In the coming quarter or coming maybe in the coming financial year, what is your capex plans, and are you going to raise money by again debt, or is it going to be only for working capital you'll raise money?
See, the plan, the target that we have is that we remain debt free. And as I said, the focus on cash has been strong for the last 4 or 5 months, and we have seen the results in the last quarter, significant results. So that's the point. That's the target we have, that we remain debt free and at sufficiently a good surplus level. There is no capex plan as such we have it in mind. And if at all any borrowing will be there, if at all, they will be temporary. For working capital, but in our plan that we have in mind, we see no need for that. Though, of course, there will be other financing costs like bank guarantees and things like that, which are associated with the tenders that we address.
Just last one thing, if I can squeeze in, the working capital days, I see an improvement around from 130 days to 117 days as on Q2. But then Q3 and maybe in the last quarter, so financial year 18, do you expect to improve your working capital further?
So as mentioned earlier, quarter 3 we have been able to generate 390 crore of cash. Some of it is related to the profit for the quarter, and rest is related to working capital. So though we are not publishing the balance sheet as a part of this quarterly reporting, but definitely there is an improvement in the working capital at the end of the quarter. As Sunil mentioned, as a part of our focus in execution, we expect and target to generate more cash in the coming quarters, both from profits as well as working capital, and we try to optimize all the opportunities that we have.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankur Sharma from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. My questions are more on the shift of ordering towards the state, which you highlighted earlier. Clearly, I guess most of these orders would be at the 400 and 220 kV levels or below. So if you could just talk about the kind of competition you have there, also the pricing. Do we also have reverse auctions there, like how we have in Power Grid, and also on the working capital? I know there are a lot of states where you would probably be working, but if you could just highlight in some of the bigger states where you operate, on these parameters.
So I think regarding competition, yes, competition is there, but it's kind of different in different territories. Like Power Grid have their own system of qualifying a vendor, so there the competition is different. And if you go to, for example, Maharashtra or Gujarat, or if you go to West Bengal, the competition would be different. But definitely today a